Okay, so our final speaker is Professor Martin Llewelyn. Do you want to come here or go there?
Matt, can I find your computer?
I'll do the slide. If you want to sit here and speak,
there's a lot of button pressing in that case.
So Dr. Llewelyn is, I think, he's very long presence since at Brighton and Sussex Medical School. He holds a contract at the University Hospital, Sussex NHS Foundation Trust, and has been Director of Research at the Trust. And he's also had leadership roles in the infection medicine and antimicrobial stewardship. He's also president of the British Infection Association from 2019 to 2021. I think I'll stop there.
That would be probably easier, Matt, if you don't mind. So thank you. I feel a bit of a fish out of water, I've got to say. This is too short, I've just heard. So I am very much a straight down the line clinical doctor who's interested in antibiotic use. And I put those things there not to sort of to show off about stuff, but to illustrate what I do, which is really clinical trials. Mm-hmm. Other trials of how antibiotics should be used, and try to wrestle with this question about how do we reduce the vast amount of unnecessary antibiotic use, which is so important. So forgive me, this talk is very different from what we've just heard. I wasn't sure what to contribute to this discussion, so I thought I would just sort of say four things which weigh upon my mind in different ways in this area. We'll talk about this concept that someone's mentioned already of stewardship. How do we protect our little antibiotics and make sure they survive? Introduce an idea which I think is a really helpful way of thinking about microorganisms, which has been alluded to really nicely in the last talk, actually, between what I term as professional opportunistic or amateur pathogens. Raised with you some issues that stress me out, but maybe haven't particularly seem important to you before now, about antibiotic trials, the use of clinical trials in this space, which is very problematic. And then finally, allude to some stuff that's becoming very interesting in the NHS at the moment about use of routine healthcare data to address some of these questions, and it'd be good to think about the pros and cons of that. So, we talked a bit about, I thought that causing antimicrobial resistance terrorism or a ticking time bomb was hyperbole, but now I've got black matter to think about as well. So thank you for putting that into context. But one of my sort of themes about this, maybe unpopular in this room, I don't know, is that we tend to take a lot of different levels upon which one can view antimicrobial resistance. And these are very high levels. And in a way, I have been troubled by this, as I'll say, but medical historian Thomas Wooden, I've not read the book, I'm afraid, just got the quote, describes the end of modern medicine as when medicine stopped killing more people than it cured, and defines modern medicine as the era of germ theory, and dates it back to Joseph Lister, who, of course, was the first medic, really, we think, who tried to use some of the germ theory in practice, did a very nice piece of quality proof work, actually, in surgery, where he started to use disinfectant and showed these patients stopped dying after he chopped their legs off, really. And so this was really, such an important breakthrough. And I think it probably is true that germ theory has given us all these things that we do in advanced medical practice. Then if it is the case antibiotics are going to stop being effective, it makes it very difficult to do a whole lot of stuff. But as I say, I have a concern about this high level view, and this famous was work done by Jim O'Neill, who's an economist years ago now, who did sort of global economic stuff and put these astronomical figures on the impact of antimicrobial resistance. And these have been quite heavily criticised, both for the lack of plausibility some people thought there was around these figures, and the way that it, as I say, takes the problem to a very high level. But I thought I'd just stick into that, some data published just this year, but they come from 2019. Give you an idea of the global impact of AMR. And really, his estimates don't seem to be that far off, really. 1.27 million in 2019 from the available data actually killed by antimicrobial resistance. A much larger number of deaths associated with that. And we regard this, in my practice, as a complication of modern medicine, but the impact is definitely worse in the rest of the world. Those top three, four bars there are all sub-Saharan Africa. And so in terms of population normalized impact of AMR, this is absolutely a global problem. But this is what I come down to as a scale. When we think to ourselves, what drives antimicrobial antibiotic resistance? All sorts of stuff gets talked about. And the first talk I heard this afternoon was about international travel, and then, you know, it depends whether you read The Guardian or Telegraph or Mail, really, you know, you told these people coming over here bringing their germs, or, you know, filthy hospitals not being cleaned properly, spreading their germs. And part of the problem with all these explanations, not that they're all true, is that they certainly, from an advanced healthcare system perspective, put what Douglas Adams called somebody else's problem field around antimicrobial resistance. Because actually, if you're sitting in the NHS, or indeed healthcare system throughout North America, rest of Europe, anywhere in the developed world, the thing that drives antimicrobial resistance is antibiotic overprescribing. Person you're seeing, who is almost invariably a doctor, we could have a debate about whether that's the right way forward or not, but at the moment it's almost invariably a doctor, making a decision with you that you need an antibiotic and coming to a conclusion that they give you one which is either not needed or is too powerful or too long. And you can really see this is so well nailed down now. You know, you can see the risk of antimicrobial resistance being different in Brighton to being in London, related to the antimicrobial practice. You can see a general practice there. There's practices that use a lot of antibiotics of different types or get resistance in their patients of different types. If you give a patient an antibiotic prescription for respiratory tract infection, their chances of having an antimicrobial resistant infection in the following year is statistically and meaningfully increased. It is about you, the patient, or you, the doctor, in that conversation. And so we need really to get inside that conversation if we're going to stop people being given too much antibiotics. And again, I think scale is a problem. So this is the classic definition of antibiotic stewardship. It's taken from the North American definitions, but there are lots all over the world. And it's all about strategies, organizations, and systems. It's not about individual people. And so, you know, I always remember teaching about this classic picture, can't we paint it now, of a doctor and a patient, and there's a family in the background looking worried. But it is in that moment, really, that the decision is made. And in that moment, particularly if you've got a child in the room who's very sick, who may die if you don't make the right decision, trying to factor into your thinking, oh, I wonder what the world will be like in 20 years' time when antibiotics don't work anymore, is completely meaningless. And, you know, this is my advice, a fun fact of antibiotic aware this week, 74 million antibiotic prescriptions in England every year. And every one of them involves a decision, should I start antibiotics or not? What agent should I give or not? And when should I stop? So that's 220 million decisions. And every single one of them is uncertain, both in terms of the diagnostic you've got in the room and the evidence behind the diagnostic decision you're going to make. The original definition of stewardship, coined by this man, Dale Gerding, who's still around, lovely, lovely elderly American ID physician, was exactly about the patient interaction. He said that it should be about the long-term effects in every antimicrobial treatment decision. So it was really about thinking about the patient. We've somehow lost that in this very sort of high-level thinking about it. So this really fits nicely with what was just being said. And it's an idea, you know, try and get across to people now thinking about antibiotics. But there are really, you know, you can divide the microbial world up in all sorts of different ways, can't you? But I think in terms of antibiotics, you can do it usefully into professionals and opportunities. So professionals are things like tuberculosis, the cause of TB, streptococcus pneumoniae, causes pneumonia, streptococcus pyogenes. These are germs whose raison d'etre, if you like, is causing disease. It's by causing disease that they get transmitted. It's their lifestyle. So the natural biology of these infections is you don't have them, and then you catch them, and then you might have them for a bit before you get ill. You get ill to a greater or lesser extent. Maybe some show you can get ill enough to be sick, but then the natural cause of disease is you either die or get cleared from your body, and they aren't there anymore. And they cause disease to a greater or lesser extent for the majority of those people infected. And for those organisms, disease is linked to transmission. So you cough with tuberculosis because that's how TB is transmitted. You get a sore throat, Neisseria meningitis, and all the lizards in the back of your throat is transmitted from people who are kissing who have sore throats. Antibiotic treatment aims to achieve, better than the immune system can itself, what the immune system will normally do, by which I mean is eradication. You've got a person with TB, you treat them with TB drugs, they don't have TB anymore. It's not there. I know that there's the thinking that was mentioned minutes ago, if you want to get disease again, you have to, you know, come back. So that's all true. But the aim of antibiotic treatment of these diseases is that you cure the patient. And if you don't cure the patient and you give them inadequate treatment, there is the risk that you will select for resistance by doing that. So the adequacy of treatment is important. But the key thing is in this room that these diseases have been substantially eliminated in the developed world by social advances and vaccination. And the diseases we now have are opportunists, really. So germs that normally live harmlessly with you without causing any problems at all. So E. coli, we've talked about in other contexts, but normally living harmlessly in your colon, but then can go on and cause all sorts of invasive infections. Haemophilus influenza is a germ that lives, can live harmlessly in your respiratory tract, particularly sometimes the people who haven't got a completely normal respiratory tract. Candida albicans, again, cause thrush, but lives harmlessly in the mouth and general tract normally. And these are carried asymptomatically, sometimes more if you've got an underlying disease. They cause context, infection in the context of underlying disease. You get ill because you've got something else wrong with you. But transmission is in a state of health, state of carriage. If you share a family with people, you'll all share similar E. coli in your guts. You'll pass these things around in a family environment or a hospital ward or in a refugee camp or in closed living conditions. And transmission is not linked to the disease. You get an E. coli UTI, you don't give a UTI to somebody else because you've got an E. coli UTI. You may give it to somebody else through your asymptomatic carriage of the same E. coli in a sexual partner, but it is transmission of the carriage state that's important, not the disease. And when you give antibiotics to people who have got these germs, you're not trying to eradicate the infection. You're trying to get it out of the place it shouldn't be, but you're not trying to eradicate infection. And when you give antibiotic treatments, exactly as we said in the last talk, for any other reason, all these germs are exposed to antibiotic treatment. You take an antibiotic, it's supposed to go out of the body, into your skin, into your gut, into your general tract. And so resistance selection takes place as bystanders, which is why you need to give as little antibiotic as possible and give short-acting antibiotics, unlike azithromycin that was mentioned, so you don't get this tail effect, which selects resistance in germs that either you don't know are there or you don't at the moment care about. And so this contrast is illustrated, you know, really nicely by a couple of examples. I showed this to the first year medical students as an example of discovery of penicillin, but this is the first use of penicillin. So we know who was first treated with penicillin. He was a policeman, and he had what was probably strep pyogenes infection of his face. Looked like that, professional pathogen infecting his face, and was very, very, very ill. And they thought they would give it a whirl to give him some IV penicillin. And they didn't have much penicillin. They gave him all they could. They were chemists, really. Their job, their specialist knowledge was purifying drug, not discovered by antibiotics. And so allegedly they reconcentrated his penicillin from his urine and gave it back to him again. But still they ultimately ran out of drug and the patient died. And I just think this story is, I think it was Nobel Prize, actually, I should say, but he died. But the point of the story is that at that time, people were terrified of lack of antibiotics because they didn't have enough. And they were terrified that people, therefore, would be miserly with them and not use them enough. And to have this belief that you have to give lots and lots of antibiotics to cure people, which is a professional infectious disease, you do. But the modern example is very different. So I just put this together as an example of the way the world works now, of course. So chronic obstructive lung disease, 2 million adults in the UK have smoking-related lung disease, 700,000 hospital admissions, 200,000 deaths a year. So this is a big, big problem in the developed world. The natural course of this disease is that it's punctuated by exacerbations. People get worse, they get breathless, oxygen saturations fall, they may end up needing to be in hospital. And if you're admitted to hospital with an exacerbation of COPD, we even call them infective exacerbations of COPD, although not all of them are, your risk of death is about 10% and your risk of in hospital about 40% of the year. So it's a serious thing to happen to you. And about 30% of those are thought to be bacterial infections. But if you look at the germs, they all carry these sort of funny low virulence organisms when they're well, when they're ill. And microbiology doesn't really tell you what people you should treat with antibiotics. The clinical trials tell you that if you're an outpatient, you're not very ill, you get antibiotics, you might get better a little bit faster. But there's no reduction in exacerbations, no improvement in quality of life. Inpatients, no impact on mortality, no impact on length of hospital stay. And the National Institute for Clinical Healthcare Excellence tells us, up to you. As a clinician, do you like? Consider antibiotic therapy. So you can imagine what decision most clinicians will make in front of a sandwich in hospital, knowing there's 40% chance of death in the year, 11% chance of admission, they might have an infection, they give them more antibiotics. So we don't have these antibiotics because diagnostics are utterly rubbish. They cannot tell the difference between bacterial infection, bacterial colonization, particularly with these non-professional pathogens that are so important. But then the other reason is that clinical trials don't give you the answer you need. So the classical clinical trial, which people think about when they see or have a clinical trial, is designed to look at superiority. So you're saying, patient with cancer, we've got some treatments, we've got a new treatment, maybe this is better than what we've got. But antibiotic trials need to do the opposite. They need to show that giving less antibiotics in some way, maybe not treating some people, maybe giving less aggressive antibiotic therapy, maybe giving shorter, whatever you might call it, it's called an antibiotic austerity approach, is no worse than what you would currently do. So non-inferiority design. And there are all sorts of really big problems with this. First of all, in order to do these trials, you've got to do absolutely enormous studies, because showing that two things are the same is statistically much harder than showing that two things are different. And so to do that confidently, you need very large sample numbers, particularly if you really want to be sure and the outcome you're interested in is bad, like death. So if you're looking at treatment that might increase the mortality, you need a very big study. And what's more, you need to be a study which is powerful enough to show that not just overall, but for all the people you would normally exclude from a clinical trial, the oldest, the frailest, the sickest people. Non-inferiority trials are also prone to all sorts of forms of bias. And the most important form of bias that we deal with in these trials is that, going back to the COPD example I just showed you, 70% of the patients haven't got a bacterial infection. So if you randomise them all to a trial, of course you're going to find non-inferiority, because the drug doesn't do anything in 70% of people you randomise. Then the third issue is that there are significant ethical issues. You go and see a patient with cancer and a new treatment, you say you can have standard of care that works this well or a new drug that might work better. It's a relatively speaking a no-brainer to join the trial. But in these trials, you go to see somebody and say, you're having a treatment which works perfectly well, and I want to give you a treatment which I plausibly think might not work so well, in the hope that at some stage in the future it'll save somebody else from suffering from antimicrobial resistance. And you might sign up to that if you're not particularly unwell, the disease doesn't matter to you too much. But if you're frail or vulnerable or severely ill, you're not going to sign up to that. Because why would you? You want the treatment which you know is going to work as well as it can do. So it's really tough. So to give you two examples from two of the best medical journals in the world to show you where we are with this stuff. So this is a trial of giving kids with acute sore ears antibiotics, and they randomised them, 520 of these kids, to 5 or 10 days antibiotics. And they said our primary outcome of clinical success, measured a couple of weeks later, will accept 10% non-inferiority, will be okay as long as we're sure it's no worse than 10% worse. And what they found was that in the short course group, there was less clinical success and more symptoms at day 6. So they concluded that you need to carry on giving kids with otitis media 10 days antibiotics, because 5 days is not non-inferior. But look, if you look at the data, 66% of the kids treated with 5 days were cured. Yes, more of them were cured with 10 days, but 2/3 of them were cured with 5 days. So are we really meant to conclude from this that you should give 2/3 of the kids the otitis media twice as much antibiotic as they really need, in the hope you'll make a few more of them better off a couple of weeks later? Here's another trial, an even better journal, compared 3 to 8 days treatment for antibiotics for pneumonia. Excluded, for the reasons I've mentioned, all the frail, severely ill patients. They managed to find 310 patients over 5 years at 16 hospitals with this diagnosis. This is one of the commonest reasons for admission to hospital in the winter in any advanced healthcare system. Overall, they did demonstrate non-inferiority. But actually, if you looked in the subgroups of the sickest and the ones who were most likely to truly have had pneumonia, they didn't demonstrate non-inferiority. Slightly weirdly, except that it comes up all the time in these trials, there was a trend towards the short course people being cured more often, which is sort of interesting, but it's never really been fleshed out in these trials, but it comes up all the time. But none of the participants had a confirmed microbiosis. Almost all, well, not almost all of them, but a large number probably had a viral infection. So the trial is biased towards non-inferiority, as I've said. No one gathered any data to suggest what was better about people given short treatment. There were no fewer side effects. There was no resistance measured advantage for the patients. So yes, a nice big paper in The Lancet, but would anyone in their right mind give 3 days antibiotics on the basis of this to somebody they genuinely think has pneumonia for community problems? So it's really not working. And I want to very quickly to finish the example of COVID, because we're all being asked in this area at the moment, what do we learn from COVID? And I discovered this document quite early on in my sort of encounter with COVID, which was produced by the World Health Organization a couple of years previously in response to previous more truncated pandemics. And they said, it's only ethical to treat patients with unproven, unlicensed treatments when it is not possible to initiate clinical trials immediately in the context of the pandemic. And in response to this, I've not heard about this talked about very much actually, but NIHR set up in about 2016 sleeping platform trials and a network of champions who would leap into action in the event of a pandemic. This is one of the jobs I signed up to before it seemed like any actual work. That turned out to be a bad call. But this meant that when the pandemic arrived, trials like Recovery in Principle started very, very quickly. And the very first patient I treated for COVID, I gave Calitra to, which is an anti-HIV drug, because that had been talked about on the internet from China. And that was the last patient I gave an unlicensed treatment to for COVID in the pandemic. And everybody else would try as best we could to get into the randomized controlled trials. So these trials very successfully did protect patients from being exposed to unlicensed interventions in the context of the pandemic, but made those interventions available to them within the safe construction of a randomized controlled trial with appropriate consent. But to bring the story back to antimicrobial use, one of the other things that happened was that everyone who came into hospital with COVID-19 was given antibiotics, even though it was a virus, because people said, well, they might have bacterial infection, who knows, it might help. And so a lot of hospitals across the country saw these original data figures that don't really convey anything very useful. But a lot of hospitals in the country introduced a biomarker called procalcitonin testing to measure whether somebody might have a bacterial infection. In May of the pandemic, so 3 months after the pandemic started, NICE reiterated its guidance that you shouldn't do this because there was no evidence for it, and it's only part of a research study. But more than 50% of hospitals in the country did it. And what we found in the study, which did a look back on this called PEACH, was that that did reduce antimicrobial use in those patients. So we are now still running this project. So we're now up to 30 months after. We're still working through data on 7,500 patients from 11 acute hospitals to find out whether or not that unlicensed diagnostic they were exposed to without any consent, which reduced their antimicrobial exposure, might actually have done them any good or any harm. And they were exposed to that unproven intervention against national guidance without consent, without any formal framework for learning from it. And I think that's rubbish, to be honest. Their routine health record data were then being used, again without consent, under the COVID-19 regulations, which allowed this sort of thing to happen, to try and understand if it was a good or a bad thing, but far too late to be informative. And those regulations have now been rescinded. So you couldn't even do that again now if you had to. If another pandemic happened, we'd have to do it again, because some have got the legal framework around which we should do that. So I think that this leads to two dilemmas, which keep me awake, really. How do we balance the benefits of antibiotic treatment, which might only be either theoretical in the case of COPD, really, or quite marginal in the case of kid with a small ear, sore ear, but may nevertheless be individually quite significant against future societal risks of AML. Because I just don't think we're anywhere close to having that conversation, really. And then the second dilemma is, how do we design research which is inclusive and generalizable on the scale that we need, with an informed consent model which allows you to recruit fractions of the population you're interested in, produce results that are completely non-diversifiable. And we're in a situation where we've got all this decision-making going on from which we learn nothing. And the potential, I think, when you consider the example of what happened with PCT testing in COVID-19, where we can move from making decisions at random, where clinicians just do crazy stuff because they think it was the right thing to do, to a decision where potentially you randomize those crazy decisions and learn something from them. But you'll need approaches which allow you to embed randomization into routine clinical practice that unlocks that enormous potential to learn from this variability using what is now the richest digital healthcare system in the world. And I think we can do some really good stuff there if we can work through the public and community contracts we'll need to establish to make it possible. I think that's okay, very difficult, but thank you.